Commander Colsera, I am Archivist Tion of the Jedi Temple here on Coruscant. I must say, Commander, you are a most difficult man to track down.
I find I generally live longer that way. What can I do for you?
We are compiling a history of the Rebel Alliance's struggle against the Empire. In the course of our research, we've come across references to a previously unknown unit. Regrettably, the Alliance's records gave us little information about it, other than the fact that General Han Solo hired you to form it.
Renegade Squadron, right? I'm not surprised there's nothing in the records about us.
What exactly did you do during the Civil War?
The Rebellion's been over a long time. Maybe it's time people knew about Renegade Squadron and what we did back then. Back then, most of the recruits to the Alliance were farm boys and dreamers, like Skywalker. They had spirit, but it wasn't always enough. When Han Solo asked me to strengthen the defenses on Yavin 4, I knew he really wanted warriors, not dreamers. Me? I was the guy he sent to find him. It wasn't hard. The galaxy was full of people who hated the Empire. Smugglers, pirates, gunfighters. It didn't matter what they'd been before. All that mattered was that they were willing to fight, and maybe die, for the Alliance. I tracked them down and offered them whatever it took. In the end, I found enough of what I was looking for. Back on Yavin 4, Solo and I started the work of turning them into a squadron. A lot of them were wanted men who were used to being on the run from bounty hunters. There are no records of them because they were so good at keeping a very low profile. We knew the Empire was coming to Yavin 4. The only question was, could we buy enough time for the rest of the Alliance personnel to get away safely? Renegade Squadron got the last of our forces out, but that didn't change the fact that the Alliance was now on the run. We needed a new base. That's when Solo told me about Alderaan. Before Alderaan was destroyed by the Death Star, Bail Organa had made a list of locations for the Alliance to operate from, in the event that we might lose our base on Yavin 4. He encrypted the information in the Data Holocron, which was encased in Frick, one of the strongest substances in the galaxy. Strong enough even to have survived Alderaan's destruction. We needed that Holocron. The information on it was vital to the survival of the Alliance. I transmitted the Holocron data to Commander Akbar, whose mission was to find a new base for the Alliance. My orders were to rendezvous with Han Solo on Ord Mantell for repairs, following the damage we sustained in the Alderaan system. Ord Mantell. Just one big junkyard, with a few cantinas to keep bored spacers entertained between lightspeed jumps. It was also enough of a backwater to not have much in the way of an Imperial garrison. A good place to lie low and enjoy some squadron R&R. Maybe it was just bad luck that he was there, or maybe we had caused enough damage for the Empire to be actively hunting us. But when that bounty hunter turned up, I knew there was trouble. Solo might not shoot first when it comes to bounty hunters. For me and the rest of the squadron, though, we had our own views on that. Suddenly there were Imperials everywhere. All we had to do was fight our way back to the shipyards, finish the repairs to our ships, and get off Ord Mantell before the nearest Star Destroyer squadron turned up. Simple, right? So much for our R&R. We barely made it off Ord Mantell, making the jump to light speed just as those Imperial Star Destroyers turned up. That's when we found out about Commander Akbar. He'd been captured while on his recon mission. Akbar was vital to the Alliance, the best battle tactician we had. We had to get him back. Information from Alliance Command was that he was being held aboard a Star Destroyer, en route to the Imperial prison colonies on Kessel. Too many of my friends had been sent there, never to come back. The Imperial interrogators there would soon make Akbar talk, We couldn't allow that to happen. Our orders were to intercept the Star Destroyer and rescue Akbar. After being on the run since Yavin, it felt good to be taking the war back to the Empire. Akbar told us what had happened. He'd been investigating Ba's Pity, a cemetery world on the Outer Rim, with abandoned ruins that would make an ideal base. Leading his survey teams there, Akbar took a small scout party to Sail Yukami, another of the worlds on Bail Organa's list. They never made it. They were attacked and boarded by a bounty hunter out to collect the Empire's reward for captured rebels. Akbar was handed over to the Imperials, but the bounty hunter kept his crew and droids. Extra profit to be sold as slaves and scrap. I knew there was only one place in this quadrant where he could do that. The Hutt slaver markets on Tatooine. Chances were the captured crew were either dead or sold as slaves already. But no one in Renegade Squadron believed in abandoning good men.
Despite the odds, we made it out in one piece and brought our people back with us. It should have been a miracle rescue.
It wasn't. It was a trap, and we walked right into it. Someone had placed a tracker beacon inside the R2 unit. The same someone that was waiting for us when we left Tatooine. We led him straight back to the Alliance's new base. It was only a couple of hours after our arrival at Ba's Pity that an Imperial planetary assault force descended on us. This place was a graveyard world, littered with the remains of giant, extinct beings. We didn't want our bones to join them, but the situation looked grim. If this was going to be the Renegade Squadron's last stand, then we were going to make the Empire remember it.
And that was when the Alliance found refuge on Hoth.
It was Skywalker that discovered Hoth. An ice world so remote it didn't appear on any of the regular charts. For a few cold years, it was our home. A place to strike back against the Empire. If the Imperials hadn't heard of Renegade Squadron before, they knew it now. We hit them hard and fast wherever we found them. Vanishing before they barely even knew we'd been there. It felt good to know that we didn't have to run anymore. We should have known better. Somehow, they found us again. Everyone has heard of the Empire's victory at Hoth that day. What no one knows, though, is that without Renegade Squadron, nobody would have made it off Hoth alive. We fought the fight of our lives that day, defending the ion cannon crew as they cleared a path for our transports. We were the last squadron off Hoth, leaving the Empire standing over the ruins. Up in space, the Imperial fleet was tightening the noose, blocking our escape. We were in the thick of it, doing whatever we could to get our transports through the blockade. We'd already been in one fight of our lives that day. What difference does another one make?
Those were desperate times after Hoth. It must have been difficult to believe there was ever any chance of defeating the Empire.
Losing Solo was a blow, but we weren't out of the fight yet. We regrouped with other Alliance forces, heading back at every chance we got, keeping the Rebellion alive, showing the rest of the galaxy that there was still some hope. We fought a lot of battles, but our greatest challenge was still to come, in the run-up to the Battle of Endor. Solo had been rescued by then, and he and his strike team planned to use a stolen Imperial shuttle to get onto the surface of Endor. To maximize the strike team's chance of success, Alliance Command needed more information about the Imperial presence on Endor.
That's where we came in. Only one man had access to the kind of information we wanted. Emperor Palpatine himself. We knew he was due to make a pilgrimage to the Sith tomb world of Korriban. The information would be with him, held aboard a shuttle. It was a crazy, foolhardy mission. Every member of Renegade Squadron volunteered for it without hesitation. Everything was in place. Solo would soon be on his way to Endor, and now we knew that the Emperor himself would be aboard the new Death Star at the time of the assault. Whatever happened next would decide the success or failure of the entire rebellion. Nothing could be left to chance. A diversionary attack on the Imperial-controlled planet of Sullust was ordered, hoping to draw away at least some of the Imperial fleet. We were disappointed not to be part of the Endor attack. But a lot depended on the Sullust raid. The only question was, would the Emperor take the bait? We took control of Sullust, but the Emperor had seen through our plan. We were on our way to Endor before the smoke had cleared. We reached Endor just in time, slipping past the planetary shield when it was lowered for Solo's strike team. We landed some way from the strike team. We heard over our comms link that Solo's team was surrounded, unable to destroy the shield generator protecting the Death Star. They needed help fast. To make matters worse, Admiral Akbar had found the entire Imperial fleet waiting for him above Endor when he began his attack on the Death Star. What had been a surprise attack had turned into a desperate battle for survival on two fronts. Everything depended on Renegade Squadron getting to General Solo in time. I guess everyone knows what happened next. Beginning of something a lot better for everyone.
And Renegade Squadron was disbanded after that?
We disbanded ourselves. Faded back into the shadows again. The New Republic needed real heroes. People like Skywalker, Solo, and General Calrissian.
And what do you do now, Commander?
Mostly the kinds of things you don't talk about over an open hololink.
Thank you, Commander. You've been most helpful.
I'm glad we were able to set the record straight. Renegade Squadron should be recognized for their sacrifices. Like I said, they weren't the most noble bunch ever to fight for the Alliance, or its most famous squadron. But I can't think of anyone I'd rather have beside me when the thermal detonators are flying and I'm down to my last clip. Wherever they are now, whatever they're doing, may the Force be with them.
Star Wars The Force Unleashed is an all-new original epic story that was created in collaboration with George Lucas that features Darth Vader's secret apprentice as the main character. And as Darth Vader's secret apprentice, you'll be hunting down the last of the Jedi and then eventually go on an epic journey of your own that leads to redemption. People will be getting a unique experience on the PSP because it's very different than anything you've seen before. George Lucas was heavily involved in the generation of the original concept, the story itself, and all the characters that we've created for this epic journey that you'll go on.
People have seen Star Wars before, but they've never seen Star Wars like this. Yeah. This is the Force Unleashed, this is in your face, this is the most powerful Jedi of all time.
We have things like Force Push, where you don't just knock somebody down, but you hit them with the Force of a cannonball, they go flying backwards, slamming through walls, through columns, or whatever might be in their path. You're able to use Force Grip to pick up objects in the environment, hurl them at your enemies. We're also creating a number of new Force powers, such as Force Maelstrom, which creates a field of kinetic energy around you.
You just blow everybody away in this huge explosion of Force power. We've been working with our developer, Chrome, to deliver this over-the-top Force Unleashed experience. You won't believe what you see on this little screen.
On the PSP, you'll have access to new and different locations like Cloud City and explore a whole area that we don't see in other versions of the game. You'll be able to explore a bar on Nar Shaddaa. You'll be able to go to the Jedi Temple, in fact, multiple times, and continue your Jedi training there. So on the PSP, the Force Unleashed really is designed to be pick up and play. You'll be able to just pick up the PSP, fire it up, and jump right into the action.
Experience that we call quick play is just getting in and playing some of the cool modes that we've built just for the PSP. So we've got Rule of the Galaxy, you've got Force Assassins, Order 66, and we send wave after wave of enemy at you, and you just get to blow them away and they get more and more powerful. And then we've got multiplayer supporting up to four people at the same time in head-to-head duels.
So if you play The Force Unleashed on the PSP, you'll get the same great story, the same great characters, some of the same great locations that we're creating for all versions of the game. But you'll also get things like historic missions, which allows us to take this concept of The Force Unleashed and apply it to scenes from the movies. Fights between Luke Skywalker and Darth Vader that are familiar from the films, we've now made totally over the top, totally unleashed, amped up, out of control.
So you're blowing away the environment, you're picking things up, you're throwing things around the room, and it's really just over the top and awesome. The great thing for PSP fans is they get all this unique content, they get Order 66, you get multiplayer.
You'll be able to play head-to-head against your friends via wireless mode. And of course, you'll have access to all these great Force powers, the great story, all with the ease of use of the PSP.